You've got to admit, those are some pretty impressive chips for a 3D printed CNC. So let's talk a bit about what I have learned so far about cutting aluminum with a 3D printed CNC together with Fusion 360. Remember, this is my experience with my machine, so take everything I say as a point of reference and see what works for you. First of all, you want to use a single flute carbide end mill. I would recommend a 6mm or 1/4 inch diameter. These offer a lot more rigidity over the smaller ones. Most of the time I am using 25,000 RPM, which is the maximum speed of my spindle. For the 6mm end mill, I'm going with 600mm per minute, which leaves us with a healthy feed per tooth of 0.024mm. When you start your cut, you somehow have to get into the stock material. Ideally, you want to enter the stock from the side, so you don't have to cut vertically. With holes or pockets, this cannot be done, so you might want to use a shallow helix ramp for such situations. I try to avoid those, because even after a lot of fine-tuning of my feeds and speeds, I am just not able to avoid some shatter while cutting. A better alternative is a vertical plunge. Again, this takes a lot of fine-tuning of your feeds and speeds. However, once you figured out your magical numbers, it's the fastest and easiest method to cut into your stock material. No shatter, and the chips look quite nice too. However, you want to use a smaller end mill for that. At least I haven't been able to do this with a 6mm one. Okay, now you are inside of your stock material, what do you do now? In most cases, you probably just want to cut out a 2D profile. Therefore, 2D contour is a strategy you want to use. Thanks to the big and rigid end mill, it's no problem to cut through this 50mm thick aluminum plate one pass after another. Start with a small depth of cut and work your way up. I'm using 0.6mm. This is a value I found to work 100% of the time on my machine, so even though it takes some time to cut through thick material, it's a very reliable process, so I can work on a different project while the machine does its job. If you need to remove material as fast as possible, 2D adaptive toolpaths are the way to go. I try to set my depths of cut as big as possible and then adjust my widths of cut. Again, I want to have a reliable process, so for a depth of cut of 50mm, I'm going with a width of cut of 0.6mm. No matter if you are slotting or using 2D adaptives, chip evacuation is important. Don't underestimate the effects of recutting chips, because you can't get them away fast enough. A vacuum is a must, and an air blast is even better. To be honest, I don't see the need for any kind of cutting fluid. Surely it might improve tool life, but at least for me, the additional hassle isn't worth it. Chinese end mills are fairly cheap and they last a long time. Some people claim that a drop of WD-40 or similar helps to get a nice surface finish, but I didn't notice that by myself. Remember, this is my experience with my machine, so you might want to try that out for yourself. In order to get a decent surface finish, a finishing pass is required. So leave around 0.1mm of stock in all operations and use a 2D contour to clean up those edges in the end. Here you can see the difference it makes. If you want to know why I haven't done a finishing pass on the lower part, well, this would lead us straight to the next topic. Workholding. Screws or clamps work great for that. Double-sided tape or superglue can also do the job, however you want to make sure that your part is big enough that it isn't going to get loose. If you are unsure about that, take a smaller cut or use additional ways to fix your part. Lastly, some thoughts about dimensional accuracy. Usually, parts will be slightly oversized after the finishing pass, so by measuring the part and doing another pass with some negative stock to leave, it is possible to quite easily get within a tenth of a millimeter to your desired value. But keep in mind that this is not the only important thing. Perpendicularity of the axis as well as their straightness play a big role as well. The mostly printed CNC allows to adjust those slightly, however you probably aren't able to get these just perfect. But you know, it's a fairly cheap CNC router, so I'm okay with that. So yeah, even a 3D printed CNC can make some big chips and hold acceptable tolerances in aluminium. I hope you enjoyed this video and maybe even learned something. Thanks a lot for watching and have a great day!